Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace, is without a doubt one of the most hated of the Star Wars movies, and pretty much regarded by many people as one of the most hated films of all time. Is it still the worst movie of the six Star Wars films? Yes, I won't dispute that. Since the re-release of the 3D movie in theaters, which I have not seen yet, but I still plan on doing it because, hey, let's face it, it's still a Star Wars movie and I'd like to go back and see it one more time. I ain't crazy about shoveling out the extra money for the 3D, but I can't pass it up as a Star Wars fan. I'm afraid that I cannot offer much in the way of what has already been said about this movie. I might be able to offer only two new things to the discussion, and that's two excuses for this movie, which I think a lot of people have probably not even thought about yet. I mean, like, hell, I haven't heard these discussions much anywhere before. So it's basically just a couple of ideas that I've had here a while lately, and I thought, why not shovel them out? And Kayla asked us which is better, the originals or the prequels. Without a doubt, I say the originals. They're timeless movies. They're excellent. I do think that they are much better in their unaltered forms. And all the stuff that Lucas has done with, you know, trying to tie these movies as much as possible back in order to align them up with the prequels. Man, he just ain't gonna leave stuff alone. There's no point in wasting my energy on that. But I can perhaps try and strive to at least find two excuses with why these movies are weak as they are. In one regard, this movie was the first one that Lucas directed in over 22 years when it came out. The last one that he did was the original Star Wars movie. Before that, he had a couple of movies, and we ain't going to talk about them just because of how bad I think they are. But he tried to hip it up, and you know, maybe the guy's intentions were in the right place besides wanting to make money, but this movie is more about the style and what we see than it is with the subtle and with any kind of character development and exposition. The dialogue for the majority of the prequel trilogy is cringeworthy. The love scene is terrible. Jar Jar Binks, I'll give you credit for Lucas. You did well by downplaying him in the last two prequel movies. But the one thing that people attack this for is the midichlorian thing. I loathed this movie with a passion when I saw it the first time. This movie was basically a lesson to myself that you shouldn't put all your expectations into something that you're going to watch and think that you're going to get paid off so well. But over time, I still dislike this movie because of how it was executed, but I can forgive it for its existence. It's not good by itself, but it does pave the way for something in the long run, which comes to my second excuse for this, which are the midichlorians. I despise them. And then, like, the idea that a germ is the explanation for a mystical force which was given majesty and reverence in the original movies is downplayed to simply nothing more than just a fluke that someone might be born with and they become a Jedi. One of the things that I feel that Revenge of the Sith, a lot of people do not pay attention for is the subtlety of Palpatine's explanation about Plagueis the Wise, his old mentor. He never really does confirm if Plagueis is his mentor or not, but I'm just saying that he's pretty much saying it. And in a way, besides the Immaculate Conception crap which they had, and like Anakin had the highest midichlorian count, yeah, I'm not going to dispute that that's stupid. But think of all that time, besides the fact that Anakin is a gullible dumbass, Palpatine spent with him. Palpatine pretty much is saying that, you know, he manipulated the midichlorians into creating life. So, in a way, he could be that father of Anakin. and that time that he spent besides corrupting him was spending time with his son, in a sense. And that's a subtlety right there, which, while it might not be well executed, and the explanation for it is not that great overall, I think it was pretty good. At least, to me, it was. And, you know, there is a little bit of fondness from Palpatine to Anakin. I mean, like, look at the way that he treated Anakin after that fight with Obi-Wan, and, you know, he was terribly immolated so bad. But, you know, maybe it was a way to, you know, in some twisted way, this evil man actually did have some care for his son in a ways. And people might dispute that for the fact that, well, he never did do anything like, you know, he spent like 20 years by his side up until the original Star Wars movie, never taught him anything about the Force Lightning. I would say that, you know, maybe I'm giving Palpatine too much credit. Maybe I'm reading too much into it. Maybe he wanted to keep the guy in check, just in case he ever decided he wanted to overthrow him, which, you know, Darth Vader pretty much hinted that he wanted to overthrow the Emperor in Empire Strikes Back after he cut Luke's hand off. But, you know, the prequels are not well-executed movies, but a lot of the politics behind them are pretty good, too. The prequel movies do terrible about also trying to play up the tragedy of Anakin's downfall to the dark side, but they do so well at raising up Palpatine. I think this may come off the fact that majority of the characters in these movies come off like idiots, but the way that Palpatine kicks off the silent coup d'etat on the Republic and transforms it into the Empire after he's asserted himself into power through manipulation and engineering war and such forth was really good. But unfortunately, a lot of people don't see it that way. I think that a lot of political intrigue out of the original trilogy comes off well because that series was entertaining. And that's oftentimes the best way that you might want to convey an idea to someone is through entertainment. Let's face it, a lot of people love to be entertained and may not realize that they're getting educated or expressed an idea to until well after they saw it. And unfortunately, these movies do have a lot of flaws, and that's the one thing that they mainly fail to do, is that they do not entertain much. And that's really my critique on the Star Wars movies. They do fail to entertain, but for some things, they are not without merit. I do still enjoy them as a Star Wars fan, but of course the original is much better. And also, one other note that I might add. I'm going to be smart-ass about this, but here's something else that's never really been talked about before. Consider this. A lot of people say that Anakin was, you know, a prophesized one who would bring balance to the Force, and he didn't fill that in until he destroyed the Emperor in Return of the Jedi. I'm going to be smart-ass and say that at the end of the Revenge of the Sith, he did bring balance to the Force. Those first two movies, you saw how many Jedi there were, and there wasn't but like maybe two Sith at a time in most instances. Hell, when the Emperor executed Order 66 and he wiped out so many Jedi, and, you know, there wasn't but Yoda and Obi-Wan left at the end of it, and you got Anakin and the Emperor left. Disclude Luke and Leia when they were born. But, you know, two Jedi, two Sith, two and two equals four. I don't know. What you think? That sounds pretty balanced to me. But overall, that's kind of my critique of this. And leave your thoughts on this. I would definitely love some feedback. So until next time, I will catch you guys later on.